people in Louisiana go through it all with hurricanes and the economy and everything wrong with the river. You'd think they'd be going through enough, but my team and I are finding something that seems even worse than all that. I've lived here all my life, and I didn't even know until a couple months ago that I live in something called Cancer Alley.
It's Cancer Alley. It has some of the most toxic air in America.
If you live in this 85-mile stretch of land from Baton Rouge to New Orleans, you're more at risk for cancer than anywhere else in the rest of the country. My team and I were looking for the most toxic parish in Louisiana. We found it pretty quickly. St. John the Baptist Parish. It has over 100 petrochemical plants. Now, my colleague Chloe had brought this to my attention after she had done a research paper on it, but every article that she researched had race as the main issue. We decided we wanted to look at the chemicals, the things that are actually affecting the people. When we picked this up, we reached out to plant after plant in our area. Nobody would contact us. Finally, we decided to go straight to an expert. So we contacted LSU professor Vincent Wilson, who specializes in environmental toxicology. He wasn't so quick to link the plants to cancer.
No one really has been able to get a handle on to show yay or nay. There is no signature disease going on in here that you can come back to. Can you show that they were exposed to that chemical at sufficient concentrations?
How can you prove that you developed cancer from the chemicals that came from the plant? And even if the plant does produce those chemicals, how can you prove that you were exposed to them for a long enough period of time to develop cancer? A defendant for a plant can argue that you got cancer from doing anything in your life, from the cigarettes that you smoke, to the food that you eat, even genetic predisposal. It could have been anything, right? After my team member Birdie O'Connell found Mary Hampton online, we knew we had to go get her story in person. So we drove to meet her an hour away in Reserve to get a sense of what her life is like around the plants.
I'm currently in front of Marathon's plant in Reserve.
Sometimes people come here to do what you're doing and they get sick.
The second my team and I got here, we all started feeling sick and lightheaded from the smell.
Well, sometimes the air is so thick you're choking. Some days you even might come out there and you might find sticky stuff on your windshield.
Mary Hampton's father bought a farm in Reserve before the plants arrived.
All some of this was just fields of grass. So the plant came, and until 6 years ago, we never knew what they were making. My dad thought he left us a legacy. He left us a death sentence.
Despite the perceived threat that these plants pose to their everyday, the people of Reserve don't want to see them leave completely.
They found us here. So they need to get it straight or they move. We want them to operate safely so we can live and breathe in peace.
The Environmental Protection Agency has done research and wrote a letter calling out the environmental racism that is prevalent in the area.
There's plenty of research that's been conducted, but Lydia says there's been no actual change.
So what have I been ingesting and inhaling for all these years? Monitoring does not mean anything if nothing's gonna be done.
The soil has become polluted from chemicals like chloroprene.
They agreed to put in these processes to reduce the chloroprene over 85%. But my whole thing with that was 85% of what?
The question is, when will these guidelines turn into regulations to stop the plants from producing so much toxic chemicals that they actually affect the people in the area? Are the people of Louisiana even aware that they're breathing this in?